have everyone's attention, we'll go ahead and call our meeting to order. It's good to see everyone this evening, and I do want to remind everyone that this is our workshop meeting. We will not actually be voting tonight, but we'll be discussing items that we'll be voting on in our regular meeting on the third Monday. So tonight is workshop and discussion. The first item on our agenda, and we do have some extra agendas that are back here on the podium, if anybody would like to grab one of those if you haven't already. The first item, we actually have two public hearings, so Rob, I'll turn those over to you for the public hearings.
As Brenda said, we have two public hearings tonight on two rezoning requests. First, I'd like everybody to know that the city of Tifton's written public hearing procedures. The city stands for exercise zoning powers. A copy of Georgia Conflict of Interest laws are available to hand out and also on our website. The first matter on consideration tonight is an application Z17-000-003 submitted by AC Going Estate requesting a rezone for approximately 1.03 acres located at 303 B Street, map and parcel number 2058-018 from residential 8 to general business. Part of the consideration, I'd like to ask council members conflict of interest questions. Have any of these applicants or opponents of the application contributed at least $250 to any of the campaigns for election during the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Do you or any member of your family have a financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in any real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it's a positive or negative impact?
No.
Prior to take public input, I'm going to ask Ms. Houston Schultz from Environmental Management to describe the rezoning application as well as the staff recommendation from planning and zoning.
Mayor, Council, application Z17-000-003 was submitted by H.C. Dorming Estates. Mr. Dorming is the one that actually put the application in. It's for the rezoning of 1.03 acres located at 303 Beach Street. That's at the corner of Beach and Woodlawn from an R8 to a GB. In 1958, the property was acquired by the Dormanys, and at that time a warehouse was built. And it has taken no other shape, form, or fashion. As zoning layers were laid, our department believes that this was just an oversight years and years and years ago. So what we would like to do is support the application from an R8 to a GB. The Planning and Zoning Commission met on September 21st of this year and discussed it and unanimously approved it. Do you have any questions?
I don't think so. Thank you. All
right. First, I'd like to hear if anybody is here that would like to speak in favor of the application. Ed?
Like you said, this building was built back in the 50s. My father, when he had the Tifton Truck and Tractor Company, built it, and he put his tractors over there. And later on, we rented it to Tift Electric, where they started up. And they ran that for 10 or 12 years. And then we rented it to First Products when Whip started the First Products, and they operated there for many years until they just outgrew it and moved out on Oak Ridge Road. So like he says, this building has been operated as actually wholesale light industrial. So we're just asking for general business right now. So that's why we're trying to get it where we can get it rented.
Any questions?
Mr. Dorman?
No.
Mr. Dorman, yeah. Your address?
923 Dorminy Doss Road. When you're older and dirt, that's the name of the road after. Tifton.
Okay. Thank you.
What are you going to put, what are you going to use the building for?
Pardon me?
What did you say you want to use the building?
General business, where we can rent it to somebody that, does anything that you can in the general business.
Right now, it's a residential zone, but it's always been used basically for, you know, some type of light industrial general business. So it really needs to be rezoned.
Actually, I shouldn't have to be coming up here paying money to get it rezoned because the zoning people were the ones that messed it up years ago.
We got to build it up.
When the zoning was put in. I ought to ask for a refund is what I ought to do.
Yeah, and we should get one too. Just for that, since you said that.
Your time is up.
Is there anyone else that's in favor of the application? Is there anyone here that'd like to speak in opposition to the application? Mayor and Council, there being no further public input, I'd ask that that public hearing be closed.
Okay.
The next matter under consideration is application number Z17-000-004. This is submitted by Bowen Family Partnership, LLP. It's requesting rezone approximately 22.68 acres located at Carpenter Road. It is map and parcel number 0046-0088 from residential professional to general business. Again, I'll ask Council the conflict of interest questions. Have any of these applicants or opponents of the application contributed at least $250 to any of the campaigns for election during the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning and reclassification of property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a financial interest in any business entity? There's a property interest in any real property that will be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it's a positive or negative impact.
No.
Again, I'd ask Mr. Schultz if you would come up and explain this rezone application as well as staff recommendation.
Mayor and Council, again, this is application 017-000-004 by the Bowen Family Partnership, LLP. They're requesting the rezoning of 22.68 acres located at Carpenter Road from residential professional to GB. Now, this actual application, the parcel actually has two zonings on it already, which kind of complicates it. It was RP and GB already. So we're just wanting to, or the Bowen Family Partnership is wanting to make that one parcel all the same, all general business. It is currently, by the Tiff County Comprehension Plan, located in what's called the residential character area. The residential character area does support GB as long as it is along a major corridor, and this is along Carpenter Road, so it's a major corridor. On September 21st, 2017, the Planning and Zoning met and discussed it and unanimously approved it.
Any questions of Houston? Thank you, Houston.
All right, this time I'll take public input. Is there anyone here that I can speak in favor of the application?
William Bowen, 2606 Murray Avenue. Do y'all have a map of what I'm doing?
We've got on our computer screens, we have a pack. Yes, we've
okay.
got the tax map from the Tiff County Tax Assessor site.
Yeah, that's good. All right.
That map that Pete has in his hand, is that the one you're talking about? Or there's also an aerial photo, Pete, that should be.
Yeah, it's good. All right, so what we're, we've got actually three parcels under one ownership, and the front parcel that's borders Carpenter Road is the general business. And so what we're trying to do is put it all together into one parcel with one zoning being a general business. It already has that zoning, the part that borders Carpenter Road, and we're just trying to put it all into one track and put it, give it the same.
Is the one that already has the zoning, is it the one that is on that middle parcel as you're looking at the map, not the long triangle one, but the one next to that? Is that the
This is the YMCA.
Yes.
And then this is the track in question. And this is Carpenter Road, and this is already general business.
That's one. Okay.
And we're trying to put all of this into one, all general business.
Gotcha. Okay.
So it's 34 acres altogether.
Is there any residential there right now?
No. There's Lakewood subdivisions here. But right now there's nothing there.
Okay.
our woods. Thank you.
Any other questions of Mr. Bowen?
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Wade.
Would anybody else like to speak in favor of the application? Would anybody like to speak in opposition to the application? Hearing counsel, there'll be no further. Yes, ma'am. You just state your name and your address.
Sure. My name is Betty Newkirk, and I live at 1580 Carpenter Road South. And I'm really just wanting some clarity as to where this property is actually located. I understand YMCA, but I wanted to know, that's the only one parcel. So what, you know, exactly how much property is being included here? And I understand a section of it already is general business. Which section is already general business? Is that near the Y? Thank you.
This parcel here and this parcel here, there's two separate parcels, they're both general business. This is the parcel that's in question, and about half of it is already GB, and this is RP.
Okay. And where is that in proximity to the Y?
To the Y?
Yes.
The Y is located right here.
Okay. So this is where the power, that power pole thing is? And how far up does it, does it go deep, or does it come up Carpenter in the direction of the,
Here's Roy Marchant, which is
right across
the street.
I know Roy Marchant, yes.
Almost lines up with that. That's as far as it goes. It doesn't go any farther, it doesn't go closer to EMC, but it backs up to the Lakewood subdivision. This portion, there's still a big parcel in between those two that is our fee.
All right, so I'm seeing Roy Marchant here, and so this is to the, if I'm facing east, is this to the right or left of Roy Marchant?
It's literally right next to the Y.
Right next to the Y.
So
okay.
It's on the other side.
Okay.
Rather from Roy Marchant, same
way. Okay. All right. Is there any sense at this point as to what is looking to be located there, business wise?
No,
I think that would be a question for the property owner to answer.
Yeah, we have no intention of making that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else like to speak in opposition to the application? Hearing counsel, if you know further public comment, I would ask that this public hearing be closed.
Okay, thank you, Rob. The next item on our agenda is the introduction of the proposed vision and mission statement for the City of Tifton. Lucretia.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council.
Good afternoon.
Our City Manager, Pete Perinsky, charged us with facilitating a process to include a new development for a mission and vision statement for the City of Tifton. We actually were able to do this process with our consultant, Jenny Robinson, who's with the Georgia EMC. We wanted to make certain that the process was very diverse, that it looked at a lot of customer service experiences from a lot of different layers within the city. So if you look at the people who were part of this process, you will see that we looked at several different departments to make certain that we did encompass and embrace all of the different diversities that come along with the City of Tifton. Some of those members who were a part of that process are here tonight. And we have Houston Schultz, who was a part of that process, Donna Pate, who was a part of that process. You also have Natasha with Patrick with the Senior Center, and we also have Karina Morano with Customer Service, who was a part of that process. But we wanted to, as I said, make certain that we touch bases with all of the different levels that were within, that are available within the City of Tifton. If you look at the back page, you will see what the group was able to come up with in terms of a mission and a vision statement for your consideration. We were able to pull this off by doing a lot of different assignments. We wanted to make certain that we had group analysis, we had some group diverse conversations, and we also wanted to look at everybody's perspective from their own customer service experience. And this is what we were able to come up with for your consideration tonight, the vision statement as well as the mission statement. One of the things that we wanted to pull out, you'll notice that both statements include the city's motto, As you know, we are known as the Friendly City, and you'll see that we do mention that in both the mission and vision statement.
Okay. Very good. This is really good. This is good stuff. I like the purpose. You know, what was the purpose of doing this and what's noted there. And it looks like y'all have covered all of the bases. It's really...
Mayor and Council, this is an excellent process. I appreciate those that were involved and Lucretia heading up this effort. In looking at our new website, looking at the city, looking at the changes that we're making, we needed a vision statement and we need a mission statement so we could follow suit with that. That's our kind of our starting point. So it was a tall task. It was a full day. I enjoyed the conversations. It was very intense at times, but then again, very genuine. For the most part, and you know, doing that and combining thoughts, I thought they did a great job, and I can't speak enough for grassroots, for our employees doing something like this for the city. And I thought about it, and we talked about it in our meetings. Everyone is in agreement, and I'm proud to present that to you for your consideration. And again, this is a kind of a jump-off point for us as we continue to move forward.
Well, I think it's important that we have this. I know within our company we have a vision statement and a mission statement. Sometimes you have to pull that out and look at it again to remind yourself what you're there for. And so, do y'all have any comments on the... I thought you were applauding. There were. I didn't realize you were applauding. Wes arriving.
Johnny, did you have a comment?
If you can't come on time, just come anytime.
Well, I was at the Chamber Golf Tournament.
Oh, yeah.
My civic duty.
What did you say?
You knew what he was going to say.
We thought you were applauding
I'm
for
sorry,
us.
I'm sorry, Lucretia.
I am, too.
I was impressed. I was like, please, he's really excited.
Please excuse me. I mean, but I had to do that. Now I'm applauding your work.
Yeah, I do applaud that. I think the employees did a good job on this, and I think it's important as we move forward on our comprehensive plan.
And no disrespect to you, but I just had to do that. But
we are
applauding your work.
He was waiting so patiently.
We are applauding your work for doing it and the people that you, how you put this together.
Certainly. I will say, too, with the direction that Pete is heading in, we were certainly excited to be a part of this process. I think it is really very relevant for the city to have a mission and vision statement.
Yes.
I think it's relevant from a customer service experience.
Yes.
And folks walk in, they know what to expect. And we as employees, citizens, and a part of the city, we, too, know what that deliverable will be. So I think it's great.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
I do, too.
Now the applause comes to you.
So what's our next step with this? It would be just adopting it at our meeting?
I would say adopt it, and then we would share it with all the city employees, and it's something that we have to live by. And again, it's a tall order, and staff and I shared that when you talk about exceeding expectations, you talk about community, you're talking about safe and thriving, and you're talking about friendliness, this is not something just to hang on the wall.
Right. Something we have to live.
If we don't serve the citizens with this intent,
right.
Then it's not worth the paper's written.
Exactly.
So that's the tall order.
I love it. I think it's great. I love that. Striving to exceed the expectations of our community, our employees, and our friends. I think that says it all. That's it. So very good. All right. Any other comments, suggestions, ideas? Okay. Thank you very much, Lucretia. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, item number 4 is the proposal from the Housing Authority for tenants covered by the VAWA Act of 2013. Pete, you want to talk
about
that?
I will. We received this from the Housing Authority. This is something that the state and all the housing authorities do recognize with local governments. This is an act of kind of protection. If someone has to move, something happens to them, the Housing Authority, if they do live there. This is something that obviously we partnered with the Housing Authority, giving a little more leniency with housing, where they are, and so forth. The only thing that I would probably offer differently is paying a little more deposit of $25. We do have an issue of non-payments, unfortunately, and given a situation like this, we certainly want to burden the owner, the tenant in this case, but I've checked around, and I think if we could probably agree to $250 deposit. I think that's fair, and it's it gives the tenant the arrangement that she will make if something happens that we need to take action. But more importantly, it is a partnership with the Housing Authority. It is something that we probably should go forward with, but that's the only part I would probably recommend that we do a little differently.
Okay. Anyone have any questions or comments about this agreement with the Housing Authority? Okay. All right. Very good. We will move on to item number 5, and that is the annual agreement with the school, with the Tip County Board of Education for school resource officers. Pete, do you want to know about that?
This is just an update, an annual agreement with the school district about the SROs. Nothing is changing. We're still providing 5 post-certified. They pay half of the salaries. They do pay any overtime that is requested. And again, this is really a great partnership that the school receives in the way of supervision in each school. The SROs are highly trained. They perform at a high level within the school system. So outside of the contract, nothing is different than last year.
Okay.
I wanted to share this with you, but I want to make it, as we talk about this, make it very, very clear that this has nothing to do with the episode that happened
right
at the school last week. It has nothing to do with it. It's just a time to renew this. The chief has been working with the Board of Ed, and Rob has worked with the attorneys to make sure that there's nothing legally that we have to change. So everything is status quo.
Okay.
All right. Does the Sheriff's Department provide any school resource officers to the schools?
No, not that I know of.
So the city does. At half cost to the city for Tip County schools.
Well, we don't give one to every school, though. Is that right?
That's what we do. But we're the only ones. We're the only ones paying for half in a system that's countywide.
Mm-hmm.
So the taxpayers of the city of Tifton are having to cover that. And I would question why. Why isn't the school system, if it's going to be that case, the school system's countywide, why isn't the school system paying for all of it? Because everybody is benefiting versus the taxpayers of the city of Tifton, which I don't think is.
That's a tough one. It's not mandatory, obviously. This is a request to be in the school. It is something that's added benefit for the protection. I can't answer about the county. I have never imposed that.
I'm tired of the residents, the taxpayers of the city of Tifton paying things countywide, and these county residents are just off doing whatever. It's just not right, and I just don't agree with it.
Now, I would probably be on the same page with you, but we're only putting resource officers at Tip County High, 8th Street Middle School, the 6th Street Academy, and the Northeast Campus of Tip County High School. So all 4 of those schools are inside the city of Tifton. You know, we're not protecting Omega. The elementary schools, I don't think, have the need for a resource officer. There's not that sort of need, I guess.
Are there county students there?
Yeah, but I mean, at the end of the day,
that's what at Matt Wilson. There's a city resource officer at Matt Wilson.
There is one at Matt Wilson.
Yes, sir.
We need
now. Jack, I agree with you. Pete, Rob, why don't we contact the Sheriff's Department or somebody from the Board of Education to tell us why the sheriff does not participate in this sheriff office, and what's our cost, what we're paying for. Could you take that, Rob?
Sure.
All right, and then get back to us and let us know. And Jack, I think we need to talk about this again. Let's let them do that, what they're gonna do about it, and then, and Madam, you can contact the chairman.
Sure.
Or somebody
sure.
from the county.
Well, it's only fair that I think that we look at the county sheriff's department with this too,
yeah,
since they are county students, as we say.
Yeah.
I mean, we all pay the same thing for the sheriff. I mean,
exactly.
Quite honestly, either the sheriff pays for all of it, because then we all have to pay the same amount, or the school system pays for all of it, because then everybody pays. But But this thing of the city having to pay for all these things, I mean, it's got to stop. I mean, we're just, okay. This is crazy.
Okay. I'll get with the chief and get with Board of Education people and see exactly, get those answers for you.
Okay, and just confirm that those are the only schools, if you don't mind. Yeah, so we can make sure that
Can you comment on any of this? I know the chief is away, but can you comment on any of this? Do we miss anything?
Yeah, we've been having the schools for 25 years probably. Yeah. We've had a real good relationship. The big plus for us is it keeps the officers that are working the city in the zones from having to answer calls at the schools, unless it's something real big like the fight the other day. But it's a benefit to us because if things happen at the school, they're in the city limits, 911's going to send us, and it really it's better for them. They got an officer right there. They do a lot of things after school and work in security. They work a lot of things. As you know, we work the football games. They work soccer matches. They work baseball. They work basketball during basketball season. They do a lot of stuff for the school. But the big plus for the police department is it keeps us from having to go out there to handle things. You got some kids getting a fight in the school. You got a school resource officer right there to handle it. You know, it's a big plus for us.
So it's taking care of itself as far as the cost and everything. It's much more cost effective to handle it this way.
Yes, ma'am. I mean, if we didn't have officers in the school, we would have people having to get dispatched there daily for various things.
Okay.
There's always some kind of little incident going on in the school somewhere.
Okay. And I have to also say not only that, but the chain of command when there's something happens. If we have the sheriff involved, the sheriff is an elected official, so he has, in my opinion, more reign. I mean, wouldn't you say more reign than our police chief when it comes to, I mean.
Well, that's be jurisdictional too. So the schools, that's a tough one. I never thought.
I mean, I have no problem the way it's set up now. Cause
The way the state law is written is school resource officers have the authority to go outside the city limits and deal with issues that have happened on school property like buses. You get some kids out in the county, get the school bus back. Our SROs normally will do the reports. They'll handle the incident.
Yeah.
But and what you're saying, you're right. I mean, they have a total county jurisdiction, whereas we only have city limits.
But our chain of command is any conflict is resolved by chief of police, principal. Such resolution is not possible. The city manager and the city attorney, the superintendent of the school systems gets involved. So I mean. Now, if you, let's say, okay, we want to split the cost to get with the county, now you got the county involved, you got the sheriff involved, and you got everybody, I mean, there's more.
I'll withdraw that suggestion and have the school pay for the entire thing, and then you're covered countywide. That's my only point. I agree with having resource officers there.
Need to have.
Absolutely, 100%. But if the school system pays for it, then the cost is shared across all taxpayers throughout the county, not just the city of Tipton.
And the reason why it's used the word prorate, and I'm not sure if that's the right term, but when school is out, they're on shift. So 3 months out of the year plus breaks plus other times, they're acting in full capacity for the city of Tipton. So I think that's when this program first started, it was a lot of grants, but the more important about the split where the county would, the board of ed will pay a good portion of the salary, half of it. That way we gain five extra officers, just like Captain Driven said, that it's just really a benefit for us. So with the schools, they've been really partners with.
If you read, it says the school resource officers shall be considered employees of the city, which I think we have to. I don't think the Board of Education has any ability to hire any sort of law enforcement officer. All right, so during the term of this agreement, with all the rights, benefits, privileges associated with the salary and benefits of the cost of the five resource officers are shared equally between the city and school, the city will bill the school on a monthly basis. Any overtime costs will be billed to the school and they'll be reimbursed to the city of Tifton. Any cost, basically retirement and uniforms are not included in the benefits cost in the package, which it should not be because they are city of Tifton employees, period. My 2 cents.
So was it half and half? We pay half and the school system pays half? Is that how it works?
50-50.
Except for retirement.
Yeah.
All right, we've instructed Rob to have a conversation. Do we want to move forward with him having that conversation, or is everyone satisfied with the answers?
Well, I mean, I think maybe we're getting down to crunching some numbers, maybe. Certainly we have, we're getting a benefit, as Raymond just said. We're also, have these folks available, for duty when they're not at school. So it could be that it might ultimately be a wash, but, when you start looking at the number of days and hours that they're working for the school versus how the hours are working for us, maybe it shouldn't be 50-50. Maybe it should go a little bit more towards the Board of Education. But I think without kind of looking at that analysis and seeing the benefit we're getting, the time we're spending.
I'd like to at least look at that analysis.
I'd like to at least look at that analysis. Okay.
So if they're spending 80% of their time with the school system and 20% with the city, then maybe those numbers need to be adjusted.
Okay. Maybe we need to tweak it a little.
Sure. Yes. Okay. And when you do that, there's an appendix. It says in Section 5, it references Appendix A, and that's not attached in our...
I'm sorry, it says what?
In the contract under Section 5,
yes.
It references an appendix. Appendix A is attached here too,
okay.
And we don't have that in our packet. So I'm just curious to see what that says, because that goes into detail about the other duties that the school can assign to the SRO.
I want to make sure that you have the right agreement.
Okay.
We revised it very late Friday afternoon with the Board of Education.
Okay.
Appendix A is the job description for an SRO.
Okay.
At one time, there was another Appendix B mentioned, but we do not have Appendix B.
Okay, it just read that Section 5 and see if that needs to be reworded, because it's got the job description. The way that the sentence reads, maybe it's just my misinterpretation, that they'd be required to perform such duties, and it's like, it says and.
Okay.
What's in that? I think it's just maybe worded a little funny to, it looks like you've got two. Should be two, but there's not.
We kind of went back and forth late Friday afternoon with that,
fine.
And I'll check look at it.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Drennan. Any other questions, comments?
I do.
Captain
Drennan. One question for you. When the resource officers are not, let's say it's Thanksgiving break or if it's Christmas break or whatever, and they're off, the students are off, do our officers then come and patrol, or are they?
They have an option. A lot of times what you'll see, they can't take vacation like the rest of the schools, like the rest of their officers have. They gotta be there Monday through Friday, just like school teachers do.
Right.
A lot of them will take their vacation time during that time, and sometimes they opt to work.
Yeah.
And save the vacation time. But normally, like Thanksgiving or Christmas holidays, you go see officers take vacation time where they can be off. And then in the summertime, they're assigned to a shift and they work a shift just like the rest of the folks.
Okay, that's my question. Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Okay. All right, thank you.
That's it. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. All right. Thank you, Drennan. All right. The next item on our agenda, item number 6, is regarding the natural gas service agreement with Tifton Peanut Company number 2. Pete, you want to talk about that?
Oh, Donna's going to come.
Donna, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Donna. I was looking at the wrong line when I saw the name.
Mayor, Council, we're excited to bring you a proposal where we've been approached by one of our current GATS customers. Tifton Peanut number 2 is expanding its operation to add a good many, about 28 more.
They've already added 14, and they've already got the other 14 ready to go. Those are semi-drivers, not little small ones.
Right.
Yeah, so they're really expanding their operations. So to accommodate that extra capacity, we'll need to increase that line up to a 4-inch for about 4,228 feet from Union Road to Windy Hill Road to their address, and it'll be coming down the south side of Oak Ridge Church Road. Now, Rogers met with the county officials and informed them of where we're talking about, and I'm assuming they didn't have any problem with it. And time will be of the essence, because they're going to want it for this peanut season.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it's a win-win for both of us. It's an estimated amount that does not have to be financed. but the company will be paying for the line just the same way our other extended farmers have done, and pay us back for MCF for a distribution premium. So they've been very good customers, and
good.
Yeah, they've been on about 5 years now.
Right.
Done good. It's been, you know, up and down, but that's been nice.
Sure.
Yeah. So.
Rob, if something happened 2 years from now, are we covered, or is
basically what we've done, of course, is paid through the distribution premium charge, and it's a 5-year deal where we get paid back $60,000. What we, you know, I did not take a security interest in the property, but I did get a personal guarantee, you know, from the owner. Certainly, that's something that could be done as far as taking a security interest in the property. But I thought with this amount of money, it would not be necessary. The ones we did before, we're talking $500,000, $600,000.
Plus, this is actually just increasing the system and looping it in, which is benefiting us too.
So I don't think we're, I mean, to answer your question, I think the exposure is very minimal. We do have a payment guarantee, which I think should, you know, cover us in the event there's a problem down the road.
We had one with them when they come on 5 years ago.
And two, the actual line itself still belongs to the city.
Right.
Even though they're paying us to increase the size of the line to increase their capacity, you know, it still is property of the city.
And it's going around by those big warehouses on Overage Church Road. So if someone ever come in and need it.
And we've got it.
Right. It gives us
a
good way of expansion.
Or the, we.
Well, we're going to advertise for that. Yeah, that's something that we would not put in, and we'll try and expedite that just as quick as possible. So we're turning around 2 weeks on a bid process because they need to dry the peanuts.
Yeah.
But gas system, where we are, this is a great thing. Yeah, expansion. They're a great customer, and I want to commend Roger and Donna for working with the farmers. And it's time to redo all our contracts. I'm going to be bringing these to you. There's some areas that need to be redefined and updated. I think that's smart business on our part. So this is the first one, but this is a great project for us, especially for the gas system.
Yeah. Yeah, I just picked up that we need to do whatever we can. A quick turnaround. Roger, whenever, appreciate you doing. But we do need to jump on this as quick as possible.
Okay.
The peanuts can't wait.
No, they can't. They won't. All right, any other questions, comments? Suggestions? Thank you, Donna. Thank you, Robert. Appreciate it. All right. All right, Mr. Wilmot, ordinance update for occupational tax collection.
Yes, Mayor and Council, we've been batting this around for a few months now. Just kind of refresh your recollection. Several months ago, we were looking at the ordinance probably in relation to charging interest, which was one of the issues that we had. The state law allows us to charge interest, but it has to be in our ordinance. We did not have it in our ordinance. We started the process of looking at the occupational tax ordinance. I have done that. I've looked at many ordinances, you know, with other cities. I've looked at the model ordinance from the Carl Vinson Institute. And so this was kind of a reworking of the ordinance. It's cleaned up. I think we had some duplicative provisions in here. So basically, the only real revisions that we're making is providing for the 10% penalty when it's 90 days delinquent, 1.5% interest when it's 90 days delinquent. The due date, I'm sorry?
That one.
Oh, I'm sorry. The due date will be January 1 for your taxes. They'll be delinquent if not paid after April 1. Also, this generated us looking at the gross receipts brackets to determine whether or not anything needed to be changed there. After looking at everything, I think Wayne Putnell did some looking, Wes and Jack were looking at it. It was determined to leave it as it is. Didn't see a reason at this point to make any changes to the gross receipts brackets. So those are changed, but now we have them actually in the ordinance. That way it's easy for folks to look at and know what their taxes do. Those are really the highlights. Everything else is pretty much the same. I said we just kind of tweaked it, we cleaned it up, and I think it's good to go.
Okay. finance group look at it. Y'all are good with it?
Yeah. Does it make it simpler to use? It's kind of simplified.
Well, I mean, you know, now that instead of leaving their information with us, it's
right. That's one of the people have some issues about giving us their tax documents showing gross receipts, and what I provided in there is that you could submit, you know, your document, you know, for gross receipts or produce it. Or you could produce anything else that is satisfactory to the city clerk, verifying your gross receipts.
Yeah.
So if somebody has a problem with submitting a form and leaving it with us, it does, you know, would allow Jessica to verify it from the form and then let them go ahead and take that back with them. Of course, it's going to be, you know, those gross receipts will be documented, you know, on the application. It's important to note that, I mean, the confidentiality of this information is state law. And if you violate the confidentiality provision, then it's a misdemeanor. You can go to jail. So we do everything we can to protect the information and keep it confidential. But this does, you know, might give a little bit of comfort to some people who just don't want their tax forms sitting in somebody else's office.
So Rob, real quick, just for an example. So if let's just say my business makes $1,347,000 or whatever, you're going to go down here and put 1.25 to 1.5, she's going to verify that it did fall into that bracket in market. She's not going to actually write down 1,345,271.
Well, that's, you know, I mean, I think we've got to, you know, document what the gross receipts are. I mean, my vision was that, you know, they would be shown, it would be then documented, and then they take the document with them.
Right.
I don't know any other way that we can, keep our records straight without.
Yeah, they're gonna have to, the issue wasn't.
Well, I know that.
Number.
Well, I know that.
Something with us.
No, I mean I can understand that, but you know, we don't have a specific number for our. You know, it falls within. You know, basically, if you make 1.25 million, 1.5, and you're a Class A, your business fee or your licensing occupational tax is $1,148. You know, so why would I need to write? I mean, as long as it's been verified that I fall within that bracket, she initials off on it. Why would we need that full number? You get what I mean?
All right. So, are you saying that the Jessica document is, you know, the class and bracket that they're in?
That's all I want. That's kind of how I understood in our meeting that how we were going to do that.
Because if it's the bracket and it's the can you do that, Jessica?
Our system's not set up like that. You put in an actual number. We don't see the bracket. The bracket's on the back end of the computer system.
But you get the form from them that has the amount on it, the gross receipts on there. So there, nobody has an issue that the ones I've talked to and complained about it. They don't necessarily have an issue with putting it in on the form. The issue is when they have to provide verification for it. They say it's none of our business to see a tax return or this or that. So she's got to have the number on the form.
Mm-hmm.
What we were trying to change, I think, where it was, okay, they can bring a tax return or a note from the CPA or whatever and say, okay, here's verification. Mm-hmm. They can take that back with us, back with them, versus us having that in the file, their tax return in our file. Mm-hmm. That's what people, I think, had the issue with.
No, and I understood that part. When we didn't change the brackets and all that stuff, that's what I was thinking. I was like, okay, well, these folks, they're not, you know, we have to verify. She's going to have to look to see, okay, you made one whatever, and it fell within this bracket. This is it. Check mark. You take your information back with you.
But even if you did what your suggestion was,
yeah,
they still, anybody that wanted to, you know, breach that confidentiality would know that number, be close to that number. Right. You're not putting it exactly number down for gross receipts, but by putting the information on the bracket, then you're gonna know.
I think
about
you still have to. You got to put it on the phone.
Yeah, like I said, I don't know any other way to go about it. Again, I think that what I stress is that, you know, this is a matter of confidentiality that is a breach is serious, and so I think that should be addressed that way. But I'm hoping that that will satisfy the people that did not want to leave us their tax returns or their forms.
Okay. All right.
Is that satisfied with your.
Yeah, I mean, that's fine. I mean.
All right, any questions? Johnny, good? Any comments?
Hey, when we get that new system, can we look at seeing if we can do it the other way? Just curious.
Yes, it is.
Wayne?
Where's Wayne?
I says, when we get our new system, since our system can't hardly do any of the things that we really want it to do, when we get the new system, can we look at doing the bracket? You know, being able to.
Do you know that we have 4 pages of brackets though?
Oh yeah, I know that. I understand.
So you have like scrolled.
Oh, I understand that, yeah. I'm looking at them right here. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
obviously.
Yeah. But the benefit of having more brackets is that you have more, you know, you get closer to paying the tax that would be attributable to your gross receipts.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. We got 6 of
them. I've got, and you may not can answer this question, probably not because it's so vague. Is this going to have a lot of change impact on the dollar amount that's collected now from a business license standpoint to?
No, they didn't decide to change any of that.
They didn't change the fees.
No.
It was just the
same fees.
Okay.
Yeah, same fees.
Okay.
So no financial impact?
No, no.
No fees changed at all?
No, we just changed the how you brought your information to us.
Okay.
Right.
All right. Any other questions about the occupational tax? All right, the next item I know was something that was very important to the Vice Mayor during the recent hurricane, and that was guidelines for local pricing during emergencies. So, Pete, you want to go over?
Yeah, I did check with GMA, and just, you know, coming off the storm, and certain protocol and procedures, I asked a question about ordinances, and really everyone has told me that this Georgia Department of Law, this Consumer Protection Unit, is really the state law that we follow. Rob may have a, you know, kind of a lateral opinion, but if the governor declares emergency, we fall under this response in anticipation of price gouging. So I think what we need to do is, if this happens again, that we become familiar with this and we post it, that this is an expectation that if someone is found, you know, out of compliance with this, that and this statute, that this executive order could certainly offer fines and penalties. So I just think everyone, business owners, need to know this, and we need to get in the habit of posting it if we ever have an emergency alert again. But I wanted to share this with you.
Do we actually have any price gouging going on?
I don't know of any. I heard a couple of comments about water and, you know, convenience. I don't have any reports, but.
I mean, I kind of heard just rumors, but I never heard anything.
I haven't had any reports.
No. You know, basically kind of what, you know, I read the same as what you read, Frank, and, you know, it kind of just, it angered me, to be honest with you, because in an emergency situation, if we have some business out there that's inside the city limits that is gouging, price gouging, you know, they're trying to take advantage of a situation.
Yeah.
And I'm, you know, I didn't know if there was anything we could go above and beyond by it. Like, basically, we can bring them in and possibly revoke their business license. That was one thing that I was wanting to look at because, you know, me personally, I don't want businesses operating inside the city of Tipton that are going to take advantage. They're going to price gouge people in emergency situations. I think we have, you know, a good community and a good business, good businesses in our city. But I'm not going to stand for someone price gouging while, you know, in the state of emergency. So that was one of the things I wanted to ask is, could we, if they are found to be in violation of this ordinance or law, revoke their, just pull their business license?
If I could look at these statutes that's referenced in here to see, oftentimes, you know, these state laws would give municipalities and counties the, you know, opportunity to have their own laws to supplement these. I'm not sure about this. I forgot. I did not get a chance to look at this, but I will to see if there's something else that we can do on top of what the state law provides.
Okay. Good.
Okay. Any other comments about the price gouging?
No.
Okay.
And agree with Missouri.
Yeah, I think that's something the entire council is.
Yeah.
Just do something with it.
All right, the last item on our agenda is the city manager report.
Okay, just a couple things updating you on yard trash. So far, what ESG has done, 258 loads to date. That's equals 553 tons just of what we collected in our city effort. So I'm waiting from Richard Golden to give me his totals, but Ricky tells me we're nearing 1,300 tons of yard debris so far. So there's a lot of stuff out there. Today we're finishing up East 16th Street, Potts, and Belmont. Tomorrow we'll be heading into 36th to 50th Street, Lakeview Drive, and Carmichael. So by Wednesday morning we should be done. We have completely made one circle around the city for yard trash collection with all the storm debris. So kudos to them. Jeff and I are working on a sweeper plan to come back with the sweepers. We've made a pretty good effort. We're on the east side and the north side of town, still yet to do. So we'll be tracking that just the same. But big effort, a lot of debris. So we're doing good.
Okay.
We shot the natural gas videos last week, which was great. We went to actually Fresco, the Italian restaurant, as a new restaurant, and filmed in there as a natural gas user. So I think it'll be positive. I'm looking forward to share those clips with you and doing some marketing with that. Chief Bennett told me at the fire department he ordered new mattresses for all the stations. The guys were laying on 25-year-old mattresses, and it gets kind of bumpy. So they're real proud of that. And
I saw those all stacked up in that trailer. Those you just need to use those as a burn thing or something, training or something. Yeah. I don't know what you're going to do with those.
Ricky Hobby made a joke this morning. He said, Ricky Hobby said, the fire department got new mattresses and I got all the old ones.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think the guy really happy with that. So that's good stuff. Flu shots, if you're interested in getting a flu shot, it's going to be on October the 12th. We'll make sure that is out to you. So if you are interested, the Ruth Cottage vigil was tonight at 5:30. I think that's where the chief is tonight. So I just want to make sure you knew about that. And then the old fire department building, which acted as City Hall. It's certainly a great building. It's located in a great spot. And I wanted to ask you what you need from me. I'd like to bring that building back. It's vacant, it's stagnant, it needs a little love at this particular time, but the ideas behind that would probably take code enforcement and inspections and move them into that building so we could be under one roof instead of the PD. And I think it'd be a really good idea to just put some money back into that building and occupy it so it doesn't continue to decay. And I wanted to ask your opinion about that. Assuming it's going to take probably about 25 grand. Wayne has told me we do have available money in some accounts that we could do that. And I'm seeking some input as to what you thought about it.
I think one time we talked about maybe selling that property.
Mm-hmm. Is there a market for it?
Is there really a need for the space?
I would say yes. Yeah, I would recommend that we do not sell it.
You know, in trying to make permitting and you know, all is business friendly as possible. I do think that personally that having that department more accessible to the public, it's kind of I understand the need for it to be, you know, they've got private records and things like that, but it's difficult to interact with that department. And I think, you know, whether it's that building or somewhere, that I do think they need to come out of the police department. But
City Hall.
Well, that's
where.
We considered it, just the space would be so tight, and for space allocation, and the second floor of that old building, the fire department could use it as a training center, or we could have again, seminars, conferences, because it is set up like a classroom. It would be very, very functional with little to no money. I see some great vision with that.
I would suggest. Step back. I can agree with moving code enforcement because it's a real pain to go over there. all of City Hall, what needs to be in one place, where, you know, we're gonna make it easy for people, where do they visit when they come? And look at all those departments and say, if you're gonna move one, it might not be code enforcement. I mean, it could be code enforcement, it needs to be here with the other, with Jessica and the others, I don't know. But we ought to look at all of them and say, well, just because they're here now, we're gonna keep them and we move code over there. Might be you move code to City Hall and something else goes over there from the city.
Yeah.
And it's worth looking at.
I'm gonna just explore that a little more, get some numbers.
Let's just, yeah, let him look at it and see, yeah, what's the best.
Yeah, sort of clean slate and say, where, what fits where.
What makes the most sense.
Yeah. All right.
Just, let's see, two more things. Friday's gonna be Becky's last day. She is, she's gonna, if the baby doesn't come, she's being induced, so send her on the way on Friday. So she's been a trooper this week. I know she's ready to deliver, so I'll keep you posted on that. And then last, I'll ask Wayne to come up, talk about Billy Stuffers real quick and give you an update on that.
Before we get into that, do you want to give a quick update on the meeting we had for the Phillipsburg and Unionville? I know we talked about that and talking about carrying some things forward. What's our next step with that program? Or
well, we did, it was a, I think it was an awesome meeting. You know, obviously residents want a lot of things done very quickly. I'm not sure that's the right approach. It's a, the area may have gotten a little, you know, too big for what it was designed, but now it's time to start scaling and understanding what limits are, what is gonna be the charge behind this, and if anybody has any ideas about what we could, you know, do now, are there some thoughts about
following up? Yeah, we need to do something about it, because the meeting we had last time was just popping smoke. What I mean by popping smoke, we had everybody there with Pittsburgh and Unionville, but you had everybody, you maybe had two Unionvilles on one table, or two Pittsburgh on one table. If you live in Unionville, you don't know what I need to have done in Pittsburgh. Now, what I think we should do is to have a Phillipsburg meeting and a Unionville meeting, then come back and have a all around meeting. Cause I just don't see the purpose of it was a good meeting. He got a lot of people together, but to go forward with it, I think we need to have like I say, a Phillipsburg.
Small groups.
Yeah. And then if you have a Phillipsburg meeting, and get a committee out of the Phillipsburg Agreements Committee, then had the Unionville meeting, and then brought it all back together. Then, you know, I think it would be more perfectly suited for that if we could do it like that.
The one thing that I've heard a lot of, I've had a lot of people say, there was so much that was going on that afternoon that a lot of people that wanted to participate in the meeting couldn't, because we had the homecoming parade, there was the funeral, there was just a lot going on. So a lot of people have said, have requested that we just have that same meeting one more time. So I know we've talked to Bruce about that. Have we heard back from him on being able to get that coordinated yet?
Again, it's just, you know, the small groups is fine. I think people want action. If I heard one thing that night, it was about zoning. And, you know, you and I have talked about the zoning, and if you want to see some things as a prelude to that meeting, what can we do?
Can you get us a map that shows, very specifically shows Phillipsburg and Unionville with the zoning broken down, and can you do that?
We could stay in limits, though. We can't do anything in the county.
Right. Well, okay.
So I can tell you if there's, and you've heard from some of the folks, is there a thing that we want to see out of the zoning? I mean, what? I heard about
The zoning. People were saying about the trailer parks in the city limit.
That's right.
You know, to be zoned, you know. Well, at one time there were no trailer parks in the city limit. And if you look in your zoning book, you'll see what the zones say about mobile home parks in the city limit. The upkeep, the allowance for the upkeep, and the property owner. But now, if you go down south central, and look at that little thing they call South Central Trail Mobile Home Park, you exit out. You know, because it's not fit for nobody to live in, but the property owner, we can't go at him because every time he sets up to it, it's my property. You can't tell me what to do on with my property. That's what he says. So now what we need to do is go see if there's a way, Rob, that we can, we can't tell him what to do with his property, but to enforce the codes that we have for this
property. What if, in response to this meeting, I think it'd be very good if we produce a map for you, especially in your district, and maybe as it encompasses downtown, but list the zoning for the trailer parks, mobile homes, and what is allowable in that particular area, because that's where we're zoned in on. And then you could see it. Because you have the flexibility, we could, for zoning, planning and zoning, you have the flexibility to say, making changes, now we're doing a comprehensive plan. If you want to make decisions for mobile home parks, et cetera, then you have the ability to do that. So let's start there. That's one.
Exactly, because Houston's been down there with me several times. We tried to address this, the fellow that owned the South Central Mobile Home Park, and his answer was, his property. And it's private property, so, and the city can't tell them what to do about his property.
Right, that's
that. Now, I understand that, but what we need to do is go look at the ordinance and see what was liable for you, the upkeep of it, and then the city ought to be able to do something. We ought to be able to tell him about the upkeep of his property.
All right, well, let's start there. The other thing I heard very exclusively about property owners, maybe out of state or property owners that own bulks of property there.
Right.
What if we do a scan? We could tell you, are there, you know, 6 or 7 property owners that own 80% of property? We don't know that.
90%.
So we could research that.
Right.
And I think what you're saying is that if we get serious about redevelopment, then we need to take a deeper approach.
We got to start somewhere.
On the code and how we're doing this. If we don't do those things, you could have meetings all day long. So. Those are the two things. If I heard anything out of that meeting, how it pertains to the city, those are the two things that I'd probably say to you we need to take a close look at.
Could we ask you to, you and Rob, to get together on those ordinances about the mobile home parks, and then you could see what I'm talking about the enforcement of the ordinance?
Well, we're going to keep it separate, but yes, he and I can look at it. I want to get you the data. You have to see it. To understand, and obviously we can't put people out. But
see it firsthand. Hello.
But it's all future. This is all future. You know, what's allowable? What your standards are? What the rules that Houston and his department have to go by? Those are the key components. If there was any specifics in redevelopment, that's where the answers are.
Okay.
One thing that we did do when we did the land development code, it's very difficult to have a mobile home park in the city limits. This point, going forward, Prince of Land Development Code, there's some strict requirements.
I'm really interested to see what comes out of this, not only for this neighborhood, because I think that is an important issue in this neighborhood, but also in Frank's district, there's another little part that causes quite a bit of frustration to neighboring property owners.
Yeah.
The classification of a mobile home park, could we somehow put that under like almost like a subdivision? Like make it a PDO? Can you do that, or can you, Houston?
Sir, as Mr. Rob said, you're currently, it's very difficult cost-wise to be able to do a mobile home park anywhere in the city limits.
Right.
It can be done, of course, but it's very difficult financially.
The investment is not.
The biggest issue that we've run across is your actual streets and roads, and we've worked on this for a number of years.
But again, the standards. We'll talk further about that. We'll talk about inspections. We'll talk about rentals. We can talk about a lot of things. Ordinances.
Excuse me.
Okay. And we'll just continue to stay in touch with Bruce and share information.
Sure. Let the next episode develop anyway. But things that you could be doing as a board, I would probably say that'd be way ahead of the game.
Tim Fields, contacted the gentleman from Communicative. The first company we put an insert in is one called Apple Foundations. They're not a local company, but this was the insert they want to put into the bills. The insert is also the coupon for $300 off their services for anybody wants to take utilize it. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to share this with y'all so y'all can see, hey, this is, it shows, yes, he's, they're coming to us, hey, this is what the first one looks like.
I can't even read that. Is this the size it will be? Is that the font size?
It's going to be approximately, it's got to fit inside of an envelope.
But you can't even read that. There's no way you can read that. If you can read that.
I can read that.
I can barely read that. Some of it. Yeah, in the circle, $300 off the little fine print.
You can read the $300 off.
Well, that's what small print, that's what it's for. Small print, that's what they call it. You don't, you got to check the fine print.
They want you to see the $300.
That's right. We're interested.
Well, what is that subject?
It says it can't be combined with any other offer. Valid on jobs of $2,000 or more expires 11/30/17. You need my glasses?
Yeah.
I guess so.
See people waving on the map over there, can't you?
I can't read that.
I thought you were talking about the...
Where's this company from?
I'm not sure. I was told it was a national company.
Florida or Georgia.
Florida, Georgia license.
Yeah.
So it's somebody, it's somewhere in these two states.
Is there a way maybe on our Tifton channel that we can say, hey, if you were interested in...
I still also have a copy of the one I had last time, their flyer that goes out, we can utilize, put up on the government channel,
yeah.
Or even put into the, I think they're also going to put that in the envelopes, also as a way of promoting it to all the customers and including the businesses that are here.
Yeah.
I actually had a local business person ask me about this last week.
I thought maybe
good.
I'm not remembering. I thought we were going to do this more in a, it was going to be local and almost local.
Well, the key thing here is this is the company came to them wanting to do it.
Uh-huh.
They hadn't got anybody yet locally who's shown it, called them wanting to do it yet. This was a way to get us started on it to get it out there. So
but there are local companies that do this.
Yeah, but none of them actually offered it.
Do they know they can do this?
That's why I was asking.
That's one thing. Somebody's already asked me. Somebody's already heard about it. And
right.
Asked me about it. They've got a flyer. They're going to understand. They're going to put in, letting everybody know, both businesses that are used, city utilities, and the local.
I almost think our first flyer needs to be the fact that you can do this, not with a company coming in from out of town that's going to compete with local businesses who are going to be paying this business license we
like
just
that.
Talked about.
Okay.
So to call them back and say,
okay,
thank you, but no, because we've limited it to local businesses.
Okay.
And let the first insert be let the first insert be, dear business owners of the city of Tifton, you have this opportunity to advertise within our bills, and if you're interested, this is who you call and give the reference, and then that way they find out about it.
Okay.
That would be my recommendation.
I like that. I think
we can restrict
locally people
who we want.
That's
I
what
thought
we
asked.
Did.
I thought
so
we
you want to, so as far as people having the ability to put flyers in our bills, they have to be a local business. And a local business is Tiff County?
Well, we said
Tiff County, period.
We said Tiff County, if I remember right. I'd have to go back and read our exact.
Mr. Grant said this was the first one.
Yeah.
He wanted us to know where they
right.
go with it. That's why I brought
right.
it to
y'all. I know they're talking about
it,
but just
let
making it
but also let y'all know what something
sure.
will look like. It's not just going to be something that's going to look
right.
Yeah, I like that idea, Mayor, first.
Okay.
Locally,
is there anything on the back?
No.
This
is
going to
be the
local
insert.
I don't disagree, but let's be clear. If we're doing it because you know those people that pay these business licenses, then we restrict it only to the city of Tifton.
No, we've said.
If the argument
if
is,
they're doing business in the city of Tifton, they have to have a business license in the city of Tifton. Is that
so
fair
statement?
Well, what if your business is located outside the city limits and you're doing business all over the county, including inside the city,
mm-hmm.
but your business is based outside, they don't have a city.
I think we decided last time just anybody in Tift County.
Yeah, I thought we did too. But why do you not have to have a business license if you're...
If you have a business license in the county, you should, if any business is located outside the city limits, you can still come in and do business here, and if you don't have a physical...
But if
physical
you have
location,
a business license in the city of Tifton, you also have to have a business license in the county if you're doing business in the county. So you do have two business licenses. You absolutely do.
We stopped doing that about 3 years ago. That was called a regulatory permit.
Yeah, they do. I'm telling you.
But as I'm saying, the reason why you have to have a city of Tifton is because your home office is inside the city limits. What you're saying is, if the business is
located out in the county, but say it's a contractor, mm-hmm. he comes in. Say somebody does lawn service. Mm-hmm. Their business is located outside the city, but they have customers inside the city mm-hmm. limits. Do they have to have, Rob, a business license inside the city limits?
There's a difference. It's the business license, occupational tax. In Georgia, only one jurisdiction can charge you occupational tax. What the other is called a regulatory permit, and we stopped regulating businesses outside of the city limits about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
We have a regulatory fee if they come in to do business for purpose of inspection, but we could not charge a business from out of town to pay a flat $100.
No, I'm not talking about out of town. I'm talking about, I'll just use the lawn service. My son has a lawn service. He has a city of Tifton business license, and he has a county business, because
we have an occupation tax. There's a difference.
Okay.
There's a business license, which is an actual regulatory thing, but then you have the occupational tax. Ours is an occupational tax.
Okay.
But there's also an interpretation of the law, and they may
right.
be interpreting the law.
Right.
But we said if we weren't regulating that business, so like you said, there's not some type of regulation tied
right.
to that business, we weren't going to.
Okay. Well, I think going back to the original question about what's going to go in the insert was we wanted it to be local businesses.
Okay.
And I think we said Tift County.
We had that argument about it. Did we end up? Because of that argument of we said local and they're paying this occupational tax, then that's who we ought to give preference. Well, county residents aren't, so that we have that argument is now out the window. We can't use it because we're going to let county. So let's just be sure what our argument is and be sure that it meets.
I don't have a problem personally if I thought we also said it had to be at least somewhat regionally. I mean, you know, it was not going to be if someone were right on the edge or something. That would be sort of a regional local. You know, we had that conversation too. So. But I don't think everyone knows. I don't think our businesses know that this option is open to them.
So I'll ask them to run the thing in the
or let our ad
so
about the service
it.
Be the first insert.
Right. I agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay. If nobody's come on,
well then that's a different
story.
A month
from now, 2 months from now, whatever.
Because you know what's going to happen. These will go out, and the people that do this will start calling, and rightfully so. I would too. But you know. I don't see on here, there was supposed to be some statement, now maybe in that small print,
but
there was
about the city
not endorsing. Do you see that, Jack?
You look good in your shirt.
Let him get his supersonic glasses.
I don't think it says that.
It does not say that.
Okay.
But that was one thing that,
yeah,
because
we need to add that. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Wayne. Appreciate that.
Okay.
All right. Any other business? We do need to go into executive session this evening, so for legal and personnel issues, so I will need a motion to that effect.
And legal issues, ma'am.
I said legal and personnel.
Legal and personnel?
Legal and personnel.
So
personnel
moved.
And legal.
The keeper of the show session.
All right, we've got a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. We'll take a quick break and get started. Huh?